We now need to move to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion 1300 in the name of Neil Bibby on ScotRail. I would invite any members who wish to contribute to this debate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, or press R in the chat function if they're joining us online. And I call on Neil Bibby to speak to and move the motion for around 7 minutes, please, Mr. Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today's Scotland's joint rail unions launched their 6 months to save Scotland's railway campaign. That they chose to launch the campaign outside Bute House should tell us everything we do need to know about how the Scottish Government is currently regarded by the workforce, an essential workforce who literally kept Scotland moving through the pandemic. Every last one of them, a key worker deserving not only our thanks, but our respect and support too. And today those workers were clear with me that industrial relations on Scotland's railways are at an all-time low. On behalf of Scottish Labour, I express our solidarity with those taking action for jobs, for fairness at work, for paying conditions, and for the future of this vital public service. Today is also World Car Free Day, a day when motorists are encouraged to leave the car at home. Nicola Sturgeon claims she wants Scotland to be at the forefront of tackling climate change. The SNP promised to reduce car use by 20%. Yet COP26 will meet in Glasgow in less than 40 days, and the SNP's stance on rail confirms that Greta Thunberg was right. Scotland isn't a world leader on climate change. The SNP are all talk and no walk, and so are the Greens. Just 2 days ago, Patrick Harvey tweeted 3 simple words, take the train. How on earth does this SNP Green coalition expect people to leave the car and take the train when rail services are being cut and our rail services are in crisis?
John Mason.
I thank the member very much for giving way. Would you accept that some people are actually working from home now and therefore the trains are very empty in some routes?
Neil Bibby.
Well, of course we have got a pandemic, but we should be making it easier and not harder for people to travel on the train. How does cutting trains make it more likely that people are going to use them? We should stop hiking up fares. We should provide more trains so people can travel safely and in a socially distanced way. And we should stop these timetable cuts so people can safely and more conveniently travel and leave the car at home. After years of prevarication and poor performance, the SNP finally decided to bring ScotRail back into public ownership. Not because they believe in public ownership as a matter of principle, but because the deal they did with Abellio was a flop from start to finish. They had to take the keys back. On this side of the chamber, we believe in public ownership of the railways, not as a pre-election stunt, but to put the voices of passengers and workers at the heart of the railway. To invest in a growing rail network, not a declining one. It's time to set out a vision for the future of ScotRail, and it's time for leadership to make that vision real. A new people's ScotRail, publicly owned and accountable, with representation from Scotland's passengers and the 4 joint trade unions on its board. A ScotRail that works for passengers, not profit, with affordable travel and improving services. A modern ScotRail, expanding services, decarbonising and driving modal shift away from Scotland's roads to Scotland's railways. If the Minister and his Green colleagues share that vision, then they will commit to 1, restoring ScotRail service to pre-pandemic levels from May, 2, intervening to resolve all current industrial disputes on our railways, and 3, withdrawing their feeble amendment and backing Labour's motion today. That is the test. That is the test for the SNP and Greens today. Their amendment does not reject overall service reductions. It's a green light for railway cuts. Just like they sold out on a public energy company yesterday, they're set to sell out Scottish passengers today. Their weak amendment proves that the SNP were all talk when it comes to improving our railways, and their deal with the Greens is a sham. Presiding Officer, on the day the SNP and Greens announced a cooperation agreement, ScotRail unveiled proposals to cut 300 services per day. That's thousands every week and tens of thousands every year. 26 million vehicle miles has been stripped from the rail network. Greener government is impossible with a declining rail network. Children watching Thomas and Friends could tell you that. The Minister said ScotRail's proposals mean 100 more services, but that's compared to a temporary timetable. not the pre-pandemic timetable. It's disingenuous to compare these proposals to the current timetable and suggest service levels are rising. It's time for the SNP to stop the spin, and it's time for the Greens to stop the cuts. This summer, an internal ScotRail report by Professor Ian Docherty recommended a 10% reduction to services. Rail unions issued a statement condemning the report, which they said seeks to exploit the COVID pandemic and its fallout to attack the jobs of railway workers and cut the services they provide to the public. I submitted a motion calling on the Scottish Government to reject the report, which was signed by three Green MSPs. Now we learn ScotRail are proposing 12.5% reduction in services, exceeding Docherty's recommendations. And what does that mean in practice? 34 fewer trains in both directions between Glasgow Queen Street and Edinburgh Waverley via Falkirk High Monday to Friday, a 27% reduction in trains available between our two largest cities. Does anyone in this chamber think that's acceptable? Does anyone? I think that's very telling, presiding officer. It means 25 fewer trains also leaving Cross Hill Station in the First Minister's constituency. Yeah, take the intervention.
Graeme Simpson.
I thank Neil Beebe for taking the intervention. I didn't shout up then, but we are wholly opposed to these cuts. My concern, as I'll make clear later, is that they will just stay when ScotRail is nationalised and things will get worse and worse. Does he share that concern?
Neil Beebe.
Thank Graeme Simpson for that intervention. I actually do share his concern. We believe in public ownership to make the railways better, and we should actually be having a growing rail network and a better rail network with public ownership, not a declining one. And that's very much what it looks like is going to happen under this SNP Green coalition. As I was saying there, 25 fewer trains leaving Cross Hill Station in the First Minister's constituency to heading to Glasgow Central, a 33% reduction. And it also means six fewer trains will leave Arbroath in the Transport Minister's constituency on weekday services to Glasgow, Edinburgh and Dundee, a 12% reduction. Is this really the level of services ministers intend to build back to in 2022? In agreeing this motion, Parliament can give its view and call for services to be built back to pre-pandemic levels from May 2022. We accept that timetables can change, but the overall level of service must not be diminished. Presiding officer, Labour are also calling on the Scottish Government to resolve all current industrial disputes on the railways with settlements that are fair for the workforce. Industrial action during COP26 is likely, and it would be an international humiliation for the Scottish Government. Are they really willing to stand by and let that happen? That action is not instructed by London bosses, as five SNP MSPs disgracefully claimed. It is mandated democratically by key workers here in Scotland. To suggest otherwise is an anti-union smear against those workers, and those MSPs should apologise. RMT are again in prolonged dispute with ScotRail. TSSA warned ScotRail to expect action over understaffing. Unite's engineering members voted overwhelmingly for strike action too. All rail unions are calling for disputes to be resolved fairly, and they have been frustrated with the Minister behaving like a Tory Transport Minister, appearing to rule out intervening use unless workers accept efficiencies. If the Minister wants efficiencies and a resolution, then he should reassess the excessive fees his Government are paying Abellio for a six-day-a-week service instead of legitimising attacks on key workers.
You do need to wind up now, Mr Beebe.
To conclude, presiding officer, the vision for a better, greener public that controls ScotRail is one that many claim to share. However, the reality of industrial unrest and service cuts is not compatible with that vision. I therefore move the motion in my name and invite Parliament to call for an end to the industrial unrest on the railways, the restoration of services to pre-pandemic levels and a new vision for a publicly owned ScotRail that works for Scotland's passengers.
Thank you, Mr Beebe. I now call on Graeme Day to speak to and move Amendment 1300.2 around 6 minutes. Minister.
Thank you, President. So I very much welcome the opportunity to debate the future of rail services in Scotland on this World Car Free Day, because no one can or should doubt this Government's commitment to improving Scotland's railways. In 2008, ScotRail was operating just under 2,200 services per weekday, providing 467,000 seats. By 2019, this had increased to just over 2,400 services per weekday, providing 645,000 seats. Since 2009, the communities of Alloa, Lawrencekirk, Armadale, Blackridge, Caldercrew, Conanbridge, Shawfair, Espine, Newton Grange, Gorebridge, Stow, Galashiels, Tweedbank and Kintore have been reconnected to the rail network through reversal of the Beechlin cuts. And in the next 3 years, Reston, East Linton, Dalcross, Cameron Bridge and Leven will follow. I want to make progress and I've got a lot I want to cover here. 441 track kilometres have been electrified and 108 brand new electric trains comprising 364 carriages have been introduced to the network. Prior to the onset of the pandemic, more than 75% of passenger journeys on ScotRail were being made in net zero emission trains, walking the walk. But we know there is more to do. And as no, I will not have heard enough from that side of the chamber. And as we seek to rise to the challenge of climate change and transport's contribution to Scotland's emissions, we have big plans for this transportation mode, including full decarbonisation and it becoming a go-to for freight. That commitment and investment was apparent pre-2020. It endured through the height of the pandemic with our continuing support for the industry, and I can assure the Chamber that our commitment and investment will continue as we shape the future of Scotland's railway. We do, though, face some immediate challenges, largely brought about by the pandemic. A £1.1 billion annual spend on rail pre-COVID-19 has by necessity morphed into a spend of £1.5 billion plus. At the risk of mixing transport metaphors, Presiding Officer, we need to steady the ship and get ScotRail ready for not so much a build back but a take-off. Labour say there should be no overall service reduction in There will be no overall reduction in pre-pandemic ScotRail service levels. In effect, they're saying that what was suitable for 2019 should be suitable for 2022. Do they not recognise? No, you've had 7 minutes to make your point. I want to rebut some of this. Do they not recognise that there have been substantial economic, societal and environmental changes since 2019 and that these changes are having and will have a material effect on the provision of railway services? There will be changes to working patterns, where we work and how we work, but we've yet to understand what that will mean for the future. Therefore, what we need is a level of service provision that meets the changing needs of passenger demand as Scotland comes out of COVID, but with the flexibility for beyond. I'm well aware that ScotRail's consultation on its proposed timetable for May 22 has generated interest and concern in some quarters, but the review also proposes positive changes. ScotRail currently operate in around 2,000 services per weekday, providing 551,000 seats. That will grow. There are areas of the country where the services will be improved by this. And a review is Mr Bibby asks where. Let me tell him where it's going to be improved. Glasgow and Carlisle via Kilmarnock and Dumfries. New services have been added between Dundee and Glasgow. And new services in Vergowrie and Gleneagles. There, that answers your question. A review, though, Presiding Officer, is not a permanent thing. We can, of course, review services again if travel patterns change again. But surely we must look to deliver services to meet people's needs when they want to and need to travel, which frees up capacity to provide more in that regard. That essentially is what the current review does. Presiding Officer, we have to address the operational challenges of the railway in an efficient manner, all of the challenges. Now, I want to recognise the crucial and positive role that our railway workers have played in supporting key workers through the pandemic and enabling key workers of the key parts of the economy to function. And everyone working in Scotland's railways deserves to be treated fairly and paid fairly. It is, however, a hard truth that there is simply no additional funding available to provide further support to the rail sector. Accordingly, if fair and reasonable pay increases are to be achieved, then it has to be through the realisation of operational efficiencies within the business. But let me also be clear, as I've been with the majority of the unions who are engaging constructively in exploring this, efficiencies cut more than one way. ScotRail's management needs to be open to better ways of working which reduce costs on their side. And as Transport Minister, as I did earlier today, I'll be pressing the Office of the Rail Regulator to progress savings to the fixed costs Scotland's railway has in regard to its contractual arrangements with Network Rail, which make up 55% of overall spend. Presiding Officer, where I do find common ground with Mr Bibby is in the belief that a public sector-controlled integrated passenger railway is the model to best deliver for Scotland. The period of stability provided by the decision that we took to deliver ScotRail services within the public sector allows us to assess the scale and pace of recovery from COVID-19 and to consider how we respond to the UK Government's white paper. I'm conscious of time, presiding officer. There's so much more I wanted to say. But what I'll conclude on this, the pandemic impacts and climate change challenge mean we're going to have to do things differently, to deliver differently. Taking ScotRail back into public sector control means we can operate differently. Both must be seen by all concerned as an opportunity, and I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much, Minister. I now call on Graeme Simpson to speak to and move Amendment 1300.1 for 5 minutes, Mr Simpson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I move the amendment in my name. I have to say I find it extraordinary that a Transport Minister coming to a debate on transport would not take any interventions. Can I thank Scottish Labour for bringing the debate to the Chamber? It's being held against the backdrop of looming service cuts, ongoing industrial action and a forthcoming change of ownership of our rail operator. And today, as we've heard, unions have been protesting outside the First Minister's official residence, calling on her to stop the service cuts. The RMT's Mick Lynch says, with COP26 just weeks away, it beggars belief that the Scottish Government is happy to preside over massive cuts to rail services, despite this being a sustainable and low-carbon form of transport. This will do nothing to make Scotland a net-zero nation and will push more people into cars. And Mr Lynch is absolutely right on this, but he might also reflect on the fact that strikes achieve the same thing. It's clear to me that if these cuts go ahead, they'll be here to stay, and the direction of travel will not be good. Now, it's easy to be critical when anything goes wrong on the railways. We've all done it. Leaves on the line, the wrong kind of snow, station skipping, fare increases, late trains, no trains, breakdowns, and now strikes. There's a lot to criticise, and there always will be, because running railways is a fiendishly complicated business. But we have to be honest and say that while the privatisation of the railways led to some improvements and an increase in rail travel, it's not been the roaring success that many hoped it would be. We should also be honest and say that nationalisation is not the cure-all that Labour and the SNP think it will be. The industrial action that we're seeing on Scotland's railways should serve as a warning to government. There could well be more where this comes from. Today should be a debate about a positive future for our railways, not a debate about industrial strife, though. That suits some people's narrative, but not mine. The Minister should insist that parties get round the table and accept mediation. He should insist on that. Perhaps he can address that point later. We need to move away from the private bad, public good mindset and accept three things. The first is that we want trains to run on time. Second, we need simpler, cheaper fares and easier methods of getting tickets. And third, we need more lines connecting more communities. That's not just reopening old lines, but improving what's there. It's a nonsense. It's a nonsense that we have largely single-track lines linking Aberdeen, Inverness and the Central Belt and not electrified. And we need to improve the line beyond Inverness too. Now, Patrick Harvey tells people to take the train. That's just not an option for many people, even in the Central Belt. As members know, the UK government is to create a new public body, Great British Railways. It will own the infrastructure, receive the fare revenue, run and plan the network, and set most fares and timetables. Network Rail will be absorbed into this new organisation. Great British Railways will simplify the current confusing mass of tickets, standardising mobile and online ticketing, and bringing an end to the need to queue for paper tickets. It will contract with private companies to operate trains to the timetable and fares that it specifies in a way that is used by Transport for London. I like the TfL model, and I think it's something that we should look at here in Scotland, but we don't have to. We know the SNP wants to take Scotland into public ownership from next March. What we don't know, Presiding Officer, is any of the detail of what that will look like or any in-depth explanation of why whatever it is they're proposing, and we don't know what that is, will deliver for the passenger. Now, our amendment calls on the government to come up with that. Perhaps the Minister can do that later. Presiding Officer, we want to see a green recovery. Public transport should be at the heart of that. It's going to need investment. It's going to need commitment. What it does not need is dogma, and I fear that is where we are heading.
Thank you, Mr Simpson. I can tell the Chamber we have no time in hand, so any interventions will have to be accommodated in the time allocation. And I call Beatrice Wishart, who will be followed by Paul McLennan. In 4 minutes, please, Ms Wishart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. There's an anecdote attributed to one of my predecessors as a representative of Shetland, Joe Grimmond, who, when asked to name his closest railway station, would say Bergen. I can't say I'm not jealous of colleagues who are able to hop on a train and return to their constituencies after a day or a week here. Instead, I'm more used to flight safety demonstrations and gate changes than staying behind the yellow line and platform announcements. As this motion points out, today is World Car Free Day, a tricky task when you live in an area that geographically challenges public transport. We must do more to break the reliance on cars for short journeys, though. We should make sure that every part of Scotland has an excellent local transport system and good links to the rest of the country. And we must make public transport sustainable if we are to see any benefit for our planet. In 2015, transport became Scotland's single largest source of greenhouse gas emissions. It accounts for more than a third of emissions. Progress has been made in other sectors, such as electricity, but transport hasn't budged. In 2018, 48.7 billion vehicle kilometres were travelled by road. That's up 10% in a decade. By 2037, Transport Scotland modelling forecasts a 25% increase in car trips and a 44% increase in goods vehicle trips. If we cut rail timetables, we certainly have no chance of changing this. We don't have a chance of meeting our climate change targets unless transport is rapidly decarbonised. Meanwhile, the current ScotRail Abellio setup has been beset by delays and dissatisfaction. People are so frustrated that for the first time in decades, pre-pandemic, the number of people using rail actually went down. Delay repay compensation to passengers nearly doubled in the space of just 2 years. And if our railways are facing cuts, potentially including to the workforce, we need a commitment of greater investment and fair treatment for workers. We support driving up improvements to services. Through stronger protections for passengers, performance improvements can be made. The next chapter for rail services needs to deliver more for passengers. We need governance that will deliver this from day one. For the future of rail, we'd like to see a system that recognises the post-pandemic patterns of travel, which takes into account local input and allows for accountability by passengers. More freight onto railways to reduce congestion and pollution, and a move away from fossil fuels on the network towards electric power, batteries and hydrogen. We embrace the opportunity to run railways better, taking the best of the UK Government's Williams Review, such as simplified modern ticketing. With passengers in mind, we can attract more people onto trains and out of their cars, all of which would help accelerate action to tackle the climate emergency. And to meet the tougher target of a 75% emissions reduction by 2030, which was put into Scottish law after work by the Scottish Liberal Democrats. We call on Scottish ministers to commit to an affordable, clean, green, reliable, expanded and modern railway with overall journeys maintained, which allows for accountability by passengers. Presiding Officer, empty, polluting, ageing trains do not benefit anyone. Change is needed now for our rail service.
Thank you, Ms Wishart. I now call on Paul McLennan, who will be followed by Liz Smith. Mr McLennan, again, 4 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate this afternoon on what is World Car Day, Car Free Day. Like many of us, I am and have been a regular user of rail services for many years. I welcome the news earlier this year that the Scottish Government was planning to bring ScotRail back into public hands. But what we need, unlike Mr Simpson, is we need devolution of full rail powers to Scotland, not the UK. I want to pay thanks to Scotland's railway workers and staff for their dedication to keeping services running during COVID. And this is a really important part. In the context of these discussions, we've got to recognise the financial impact that the pandemic has had on ScotRail. The update we all received today showed revenues are only at 50% of pre-pandemic level. That's the reality. And we must acknowledge that this Scottish Government has invested record levels to improve connectivity and increase the number of trains across Scotland's rail network. Transport Minister mentioned in the last 10 years the Scottish Government has invested £1 billion in some 441 kilometres, track kilometres of electrification and associated infrastructure improvements, directly benefiting over 35 million passenger journeys each year. In my own constituency, East Linton Station has just been granted planning permission, and I only just met with Network Rail this morning to discuss timelines on construction. There was also an investment of additional platform in Dunbar. Employment in the railway in Scotland is at its highest level ever under this government, with over 9,000 jobs and many others in the supply chain. COVID-19 has changed how and where we live, work and travel. Companies and organisations are reviewing the way they work. Hybrid working will become the norm. And indeed, a recent report from the World Economic Forum found that 49% would prefer home working after a pandemic, with another 30% preferring a hybrid model. Two-thirds of companies are actively looking at home and hybrid working models. Two-thirds. ScotRail is seeking to develop a timetable which will better meet future travel patterns, significantly reduce the unsustainable burden on the public purse of running more trains than are needed. Many communities across Scotland have reconnected to the rail network, including Alloa, Caldercrew and the Borders Railway communities. Open new stations on the Airdrie to Bathgate line and the Borders line. The Scottish Government has allocated a record £4.85 billion to maintain and enhance Scotland's railway in the current control period. This future investment includes continued electrification and decarbonisation through our rail services. The consultation on the proposed new timetable provides an opportunity for ScotRail customers and businesses to help shape a reliable and responsive timetable. This is a starting point, not the end. It's time to recognise... No, I'm sorry, I'm conscious of the time. It's time to recognise the challenges that we face on the railway and find a way to build back from the pandemic in a manner that delivers a more sustainable and efficient service that is ready to meet future demand. The Scottish Government and Scottish Ministers are committed to an affordable, clean, green, reliable and modern railway that is publicly owned and accountable and founded on Fair Work First criteria, decarbonising our passenger rail services, meeting Scotland's net zero ambitions. Support the Scottish Government amendment. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McLennan. I now call on Liz Smith, who will be followed by Richard Leonard. Ms Smith, again, 4 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'm very grateful for the opportunity to speak in this debate. Such is the very strong concern that has been expressed by many of my constituents across Mid-Scotland and Fife, but most especially by those who live in the Perth to Edinburgh M90 corridor and in the area around Kirkcaldy and Central Fife, and those near to Dunblane. These are people who have been in touch because they are very concerned about what the proposed 2022 changes would mean for them and their families. And I don't think that there is any other way to describe what is contained in these proposals other than cuts to rail services. Because in percentage terms across Scotland, it would work out as a 12% reduction since the pre-pandemic year. And I also fully understand why and sympathise with those passengers and rail workers who feel badly let down by this, because it has an impact not just on the services, but also on jobs. Now, the Scottish Government implies in its motion that Professor Doherty's report is about building back pre-pandemic levels, but also providing for future demand. And I want to examine this just a little bit further. I think it was Mr Mason earlier this afternoon who quite rightly, if I may say so, pointed out that working patterns are changing, perhaps on a permanent basis, and there will definitely be more people who will choose to work at home, people who previously would have been commuting to work in offices. But that fall in demand has to be set against the regional demographic changes and also against what we are told is a wider Scottish Government policy when it comes to the green agenda. And let me explain about that, because the proposed removal of the direct link Edinburgh to Perth has been a particular concern, because the rerouting of Perth to Edinburgh via Dunfermline will actually add 10 minutes to a journey time to our rail services is already well over the time of comparable journeys in the rest of the UK and in Europe. And let's be honest, that's been precisely why we've been campaigning for the last 20 years for an upgrade to the rail infrastructure between Edinburgh to Perth, based on the fact that we want to get more people onto greener transport, making trains much more competitive with roads. But surely we also have to pay attention to the extent of the population growth that is happening around the western edge of Perth City and around the hinterland of Kinross and Milnathort, where a large proportion of the working population is travelling to Edinburgh and to Glasgow. And neither should we forget that Perth Station is supposed to be the hub for Dundee, Aberdeen and Inverness, which is exactly why bodies like Transform have been presenting such a cogent case when it comes to infrastructure developments. But it's surely very important that ScotRail recognises that all of this when it comes to timetabling its future services. Now, such was my concern about all of this that I asked to meet with the ScotRail officials on the 6th of September, and they effectively told me that they are going to push ahead with these changes because there is so little that they can do regarding the constraints of the current infrastructure to make ScotRail services competitive against road. And I understand that concern, but that, and of course that's not their responsibility, but I'm afraid I don't accept what they are proposing for 2022 is going to be the right answer. And obviously there are concerns in other parts of Mid-Scotland and Fife about the proposed end to the direct link between Dunblane and Glasgow, necessitating a change at Stirling, and to some of the central Fife areas where they're going to have more changes at Inverkeithing. Now, people are telling us quite clearly that they want trains to be accessible, to run on time, to be clean and efficient. They do not want slower trains, cancellations and trains that are less competitive with car journeys. Nor do they want a service which, Graeme Simpson pointed out, is functioning against a backdrop of uneasy relationships with government and with passengers. Deputy Presiding Officer, good quality transport has to be at the heart of economic policy making, and I suggest we learn a lot from what is going on in some of our European neighbours where they know how to get train services right.
Thank you, Ms Smith. I now call on Richard Leonard, who will be followed by Emma Roddick. Mr Leonard, again, 4 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, and can I refer members to my register of interests? Let me begin with the facts. Abellio ScotRail is fully funded by the Scottish Government. Fact. Even before the introduction of the Emergency Measures Agreement, the Scottish Government funded two-thirds of ScotRail Abellio's revenue. Fact. The Scottish Government has announced its intention to bring the ScotRail franchise into public ownership. Fact. The Scottish Government now has complete control of the ScotRail franchise. Fact. So why is it? And I ask Scottish Green backbenchers and frontbenchers, as well as the Minister, why is it that the Scottish Government, in presiding over the commissioning of the Doherty report, although no one is claiming responsibility for it, and now refusing to rule out implementing the recommendations of the Doherty report, is doing so, knowing that it will mean a radical cut in Scotland's rail services, a radical cut in the workforce, a radical cut in ticket offices. No wonder Professor Doherty himself says his plans, I quote, will require addressing difficult cultural and political questions. When I tackled the minister on this in a written parliamentary question last month, he replied that Transport Scotland was working to, and I quote him, provide a platform, sick, to assess the scale and pace of recovery from COVID-19. And the minister spoke of, in his words, changing priorities and requirements of rail passengers. As usual, the minister did not answer the question I asked, but significantly, he did not deny that the Scottish Government was making its own assessment of the Doherty cuts. So we make a simple, uncomplicated call on the Scottish Government today. Rule out cuts to rail services in Scotland. At a time of climate crisis, we should be expanding our railways, not contracting them. In plain terms, I know the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero Energy and Transport is not here, but he was a late convert to ending the rail privatisation experiment. But I say to him, to the Minister and to the Government today, in all sincerity, the railways in public ownership run for passengers, not profits, are part of the solution to the climate change crisis, not part of the problem. And the other question is this. With the Scottish Government in complete control of the ScotRail franchise, why is the Cabinet Secretary and the Minister for Transport presiding over Britain's longest-running industrial dispute? Why is it, when anti-trade union laws demand that the workforce re-ballot, these hard-working senior conductors and ticket examiners, these key workers, at the very point they are re-balloting,
Why is it five SNP MSPs in Glasgow decided to issue a joint statement attacking their trade union and calling on the workers to collapse the strike or break the strike? Why didn't they instead issue a joint statement calling on ScotRail and their own government to address this pay injustice, end this pay freeze and settle this dispute? And finally, I say to them, do they not recall the words of the Cabinet Secretary for Finance, who in March 2021 said, I am clear that the pay freeze announced by the Chancellor fundamentally misjudges the value of frontline workers. I think the SNP, supported by the Greens in government, is fundamentally misjudging the value of these frontline workers. So I call on the government and this Parliament to get on the side of Scotland's railway workers and all of their unions. Drop the planned cuts to rail services. Drop the planned cuts to rail jobs. Drop the planned cuts to terms and conditions. And back the Labour motion at decision time tonight.
Thank you very much, Mr Leonard. I now call on Emma Roddick, who will be followed by Dean Lockhart. Ms Roddick, again, 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As someone for whom it is an everyday reality, I've spent over 48 hours on trains in the last month, folk hamming up on World Car Day, World Car Free Day, the grave disruption to their lives that would come from not using their car for a 20-minute journey out of one day out of 365 really does jar. So I do thank my colleagues on the Labour benches for giving me this opportunity to make productive use of my irrational annoyance. However, being a Highlands and Islands representative, I do understand that not only is going car-free difficult for many of my constituents, it is impossible. If you live in Alness and you work in a care home in Barbourville, how do you get to your night shift when the last bus has long gone? However, there are many, I accept, who could make the switch from car to public transport, but they don't because we're not yet giving them good reason to. When the journey from Thurso to Inverness is 4 hours on the train and 2 hours 20 in a car, why would you take the train if you can drive? Friends of the Far North Line pointed out in their latest issue, and I think it's fair to say all of their issues, that most of the Highland Main Line remains single track, asking when will the sun shine on the Highland Main Line? Now, the need for doubling this route is something I've already raised twice in this chamber, and I expect a number of my colleagues will be sick of hearing about it from me fairly soon and until it happens. Considering both the massive carbon efficiency benefits and the fact that massive lorries carrying freight which could be transported by rail, not to mention the issues currently around who drives those lorries, are the cause of many issues on the A9. It is great to see mention of moving more freight onto our railways in the government amendment. However, you can only go so far with that while the Highland Main Line remains single track. If we're talking about the benefit to the climate, I think it surely makes sense to move freight off the roads and onto rail where the journeys are the longest and therefore the carbon emissions are the highest. It is fantastic, really fantastic, that we're talking so much about decarbonising public transport, about electrifying and exploring ways to hydrogen power trains on existing routes like the West Highland Line. But having control of the franchise surely means that we have to go further than improving what's there. We also have to make sure that the services and the timetables are working not only for those who currently use them, but those who can be convinced. I do find it utterly bizarre that some of the justification for service reductions from ScotRail at the moment are using current passenger numbers. Firstly, you can't use that at a time where people were actively being told not to use the train as any kind of basis for decision making. And we should be looking forward to the future and using the opportunity of service changes to encourage more users. So I'm glad also to see a mention of that in the Scottish Government amendment. I was as excited as a child at Christmas, or myself at Christmas, when I heard the announcement that the government was taking over ScotRail ownership, more so now that there is a commitment to putting staff and passengers at the heart of governance. I do share in the disappointment that in the wake of that, timetable changes show that we're still not using high-speed trains to service Inverness, the city with the longest intercity routes in the country, which surely should mean it's top of the list for dunting trains which have been described by ScotRail and the Scottish Government as not suited for intercity travel. ScotRail being brought into public hands provides us with a massive opportunity to get things right, and I think both the Labour motion and the Scottish Government amendment recognise that, and I look forward to working with my colleagues across the Chamber and including Scottish Labour to make sure that that does happen.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Ruddock. I now call on Dean Lockhart, who will be followed by Mark Ruskell. Mr Lockhart, again, 4 minutes, please.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. In 6 months' time, as we've heard, ScotRail will enter public ownership and a new National Rail Service will be created, a development that will not only shape the future of our railways and the jobs involved, but will also have a significant influence on our journey to net zero. Given the significance of these plans, we've heard remarkably little from the Scottish Government about the details of what will be involved, and also given the significance of this policy, the Scottish Government must resist the temptation to railroad these plans through Parliament, pun intended, with the help of the Greens. Whatever these plans involve, they must involve full parliamentary and committee scrutiny, widespread stakeholder and worker consultations, as well as a long-term strategic plan for Scotland's railways. We've seen in the past what happens when this government intervenes to bring assets into public ownership without that consultation, without long-term planning and without proper scrutiny. When Ferguson Marine was nationalised 2 years ago, there was no prior consultation, no plan in place, despite warnings, including from these benches, that it would damage the yard's ability to win future work. We saw the same with the intervention in BIFAB. Again, no consultation, no long-term plan. The same with Prestwick Airport. And we saw the same flawed approach being taken by the SNP with the proposed publicly owned energy company. A policy announced by the SNP without consultation, only for the government then to spend £500,000 on consultancy fees to be told the policy wouldn't work. Presiding Officer, this flawed approach has to change. There has to be a better way to plan for the future of Scotland's railways. And if the government needs help with its long-term planning for the railways, I think my colleague Graeme Simpson set out some very clear objectives in his opening remarks that I hope we can all support. For the trains to run on time, simpler, cheaper fares and easier methods of getting tickets, more lines connecting more communities. We have announced that as part of our manifesto. A railway network that works across Scotland, England and Wales. And also, the government needs to tell us how these plans will help deliver the transition to net zero. On this last point, there are many recommendations in the Williams Rail Review that merit close consideration by the Scottish Government. And I would say this to the Minister, not to let narrow political interests get in the way of following good policy elsewhere in the UK. Presiding Officer, we don't just need that long-term plan for railways in Scotland. We also need to see an immediate resolution to the industrial dispute that has been going on for 6 months and causing disruption across Scotland. A strike which, if unresolved in 5 weeks' time, could threaten to disrupt the COP26 climate change conference to be held in Glasgow. Scotland will host up to 20,000 delegates, with events being held across Glasgow, Edinburgh and other venues across Scotland, with rail connectivity being critical to the success of the conference. For a government that claims to be world-leading, not being able to run the trains during COP26 would be an embarrassment for the whole of Scotland. And that's why we're calling on the Minister to get involved, to work with ScotRail and the unions to get this dispute resolved. It has gone on way too long. Presiding Officer, let me conclude by saying that passengers and workers across Scotland deserve a government that gives our railways more support, more financing and more attention. They're not getting that from this SNP government. I support the amendment in Graeme Simpson's name.
Thank you very much, Mr Lockhart. I now call on Mark Ruskell, who will be followed by the last speaker in the open debate, John Mason. Again, Mr Ruskell, 4 minutes,
please.
Thank you,
Presiding Officer. Can I thank Labour colleagues for bringing this debate forward this afternoon? I think it's important that we thank the workers for their commitment to delivering rail services during the pandemic. And it's also important that we push Abellio to get round the table with our unions and resolve this industrial dispute well ahead of COP26. Now, the motion references car-free day, and I think it is a reminder of why we need to urgently transform our transport system. If we don't get the system right, then the 70% who do have access to a car will simply drive more, while those who don't have car access will be even further disadvantaged than they are already. Now, rail must be at the heart of the government's plan for 20% reduction in traffic, and the transfer of ScotRail into public ownership next year must mark a relaunch of rail in Scotland, a genuine people's railway, a service run in the public interest, with a direct role for passengers and workers in the planning and delivering of services, reaching out to communities who are currently not served by the rail network, and passengers that, to be honest, could be served a lot better. Now, I am concerned that the focus of the Doherty report and the subsequent ScotRail timetable proposals have been based on service cuts and facilities closures across Scotland's rail network, rather than changes that can genuinely create room for further expansion and improvement of services. Now, the report claimed to make these recommendations due to changed passenger behaviour and the need for economic recovery from COVID, but in many ways, and as the point's already been made, that it is still too early to say how rail use will recover post the pandemic, given that many workplaces have understandably yet to invite workers fully back to the office. Now, you know, we know that ScotRail is currently consulting on their national proposed timetable, with responses closing on the 1st of October. I don't have time in hand. I'm sorry, unless I do have time in hand. I don't think I do.
I can give you a little bit of time back.
Okay, I'll take it.
As briefly as possible, Mr.
Very brief.
Mark Ruskell say what the Scottish Greens' submission to that consultation will be? Do they accept ScotRail's Fit for the Future proposals to cut 300 services a day or not?
Mr. Ruskell.
Well, no. And I'll tell you what I am actually doing to actually listen to the people, listen to the travelling public, and actually channel their comments, not only to ScotRail, but to the Minister as well. So I've been actively encouraging constituents across my region to make their voices heard. And over 300 people have engaged with a consultation portal that I've set up. And they've already told ScotRail what they think of the cuts. And ScotRail have confirmed to me today that they'll be attending a town hall event that I'll be organising online next week to explain themselves to the people what those timetable changes are and to hear directly from passengers across my region about how those changes will affect them, the people actually having their voice and having their say on this issue. Now, how ScotRail deals with responses to this consultation will be a big test. We expect full transparency, what concerns were raised with them, and the action that they'll take to address those concerns before the final proposals are then passed on to the Minister for a decision. Now, I acknowledge that some change will be necessary. No one wants to see empty trains running, and the rail network must be used efficiently, and there may be timetable changes that meet passenger demand better than they do currently. But what we've seen come through the changes so far is of real concern. For example, Kirkcaldy to Perth would take up to 30 minutes longer with no direct train between the two places and less frequent journey times. Journeys within Fife will require a change at Inverkeithing, which also lead to increased journey times. Passengers in Strathearn may benefit from more regular services from Gleneagles, but for Perth residents, they will see the current problems with journey times even more compounded. So if the message is that it will become harder to take the train between Perth and Scotland's other cities, that will be incredibly damaging to the government's target of securing 20% reduction in vehicle mileage. So I really hope, in concluding, Presiding Officer, that the Minister will listen to passengers. I'm sure he will, and he will listen to the workers as well. And we look forward to that successful relaunch of a people's railway next year.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ruskell. And the final speaker in the open debate is John Mason. Again, 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, and I do welcome the chance to take part in today's debate. I think there's no question that we face some very challenging decisions around travel in general and rail travel in particular. On the one hand, we want a world-class rail service carrying passengers and freight everywhere they want to go. But on the other hand, we need to be thinking about the environment, and perhaps many of us were travelling too much before COVID, and we have now learned to travel less. In particular for myself, travelling each week from Glasgow via Bathgate to Edinburgh on the train, the reduction in passengers getting off at Edinburgh Park Station has been quite remarkable. Will they ever return to previous work patterns? I do not think anyone knows, as Mark Ruskell just said. The other side to all this, of course, is the financial aspect. As with all parts of the budget, we have to live within our means. I strongly support having the railways under public ownership. And while we're at it, did not like seeing gas and electricity privatised as well. But they will still have to operate within a budget. Broadly speaking, if there's to be a pay increase above inflation, there will need to be a matching increase in fares above inflation. Or, if fares are to be held down, wages will have to be held down too. I have to say that the last time the rail was in the public hands, the public did not always get a good deal. The awful British Rail sandwiches were a standing joke. So this time round, the passengers and other users have to be at the centre. And from that perspective, I agree with the line in the Conservative amendment which says any operating model must put delivering a reliable and affordable service for passengers at the heart of its aim. I'm not sure if that's good English, but never mind. So, as we move towards new ownership of the railways, I think we need to remember that the railways are not there to serve us as politicians, neither are they there to serve the RMT or the staff of the railways, much as we appreciate them and especially the work they did during the pandemic. The railways are there to serve the public, and both we as politicians and the staff who work in the railways are there to serve the public too. If fewer people are travelling by train because of working at home, nervousness about being in a busy public place or for any other reasons, then the railway system will have less income than it did pre-COVID. So that shortfall has to be made up in some way. For example, we could increase fares. We could increase the public subsidy, for example, by cutting the NHS budget. Or we could trim services to better match demand. I think these are the three main options we have, and I hope Labour in particular will seriously engage in this debate. It's very easy to say that we want more services, we want increased pay, we want reduced fares, but sadly the numbers have to stack up. It's okay, I'm not being promoted. Yep, on you go.
Mr. Bibby.
I agree with public transport is a public service, and the state will have to support that public service, but if you're not willing to invest in public transport, there is no point declaring a climate emergency. We're declaring a climate emergency. We need to invest in public transport in order to get people using public transport, and that is going to require greater public investment.
John Mason, I can give you back most of that time.
Thanks very much. I mean, of course we need to invest, but we can only invest the money we have. And I mean, Mr. Bibby lives within a budget. He's got a family, as I understand it. I have to live within my budget. We all have to live within our budgets. So it's all very well saying there should be all these things we'd like to see, but we can only do it if the money is actually there. Moving on to some of the specific service proposals, I welcome the fact that Glasgow North Electric's, including Edinburgh to Helensburgh, looks like staying broadly the same. On Glasgow-Edinburgh via Falkirk High, it is a bit disappointing that the previous all-day 15-minute service will reduce to 30 minutes off-peak. I do understand this, and based on my previous arguments, the money has to come from somewhere. But given this, in many ways, is ScotRail's flagship route, given the investment in Queen Street Station, and given the electrification of the route and the excellent rolling stock, it is still disappointing. Hopefully, if demand picks up, services can be increased. I love getting the train from places like Inverness to Wick and similar of the rural routes, but that is one of the most heavily subsidised lines. The average fare is £7 and the subsidy is £25 per passenger. I'm not arguing against that, but I just wonder if Labour is seriously arguing that we should increase that subsidy even more, above 75%.
It's not just because you're commenting on this part of the line, but you will need to actually conclude now,
final.
Mr. Mason.
Right, I'll just stop there. Okay, right.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mason. We now move to closing speeches. I call Liam Kerr, 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've listened very carefully to the debate today, and with only 4 minutes, I have a very limited time to pick the key issues. The first thing to say is that we can support the first part of the Labour motion, resisting the reduction in ScotRail services. The second thing, which this afternoon makes abundantly clear, is the utter abdication of responsibility from this Scottish Government. In relation to the pay dispute, that is something that was evident long before today. Indeed, in June, I asked the First Minister about this, and she said it was for the employer to resolve, and the matter rests with the operator and the unions. It's a position we've heard today from the Minister and Mark Ruskell, and is reflected in the Scottish Government amendment. But there are three reasons why this shameful abdication just doesn't stack up. Firstly, ScotRail has been operating under an emergency management agreement. Section 5.5C of Appendix 2 to Schedule 1 of the Supplemental Agreement makes clear that Abellio can negotiate all they want, but they cannot authorise anything without ultimately the consent of the Scottish ministers, as ultimately that is where the funding will come from. But just in case I was mistaken on that, I dug out the franchise agreement. Schedule 15.2, Clause 2.1, on page 617, states that in the last 12 months of a franchise, Abellio shall not vary or promise to vary the terms or conditions of employment of employees without the prior consent of the Scottish ministers. And in any event, under employment law, Tupi says that Any purported variation of a contract of employment that is or will be transferred is void if the sole or principal reason for the variation is the transfer. Now, of course, there are caveats to that, but as the future transferee, one would have thought the Scottish Government should be actively discussing with the transferor what it would expect to see post-transfer. So I don't accept the Scottish Government's position of sitting on their hands and hoping that Abellio and the unions will fight it out. That is just not acceptable. Secondly, Mr Simpson's amendment calls for the Scottish Government to undertake a review of disused tracks and stations and reopen those that would support local growth and connectivity, and notes that for many people across Scotland, particularly in rural areas, car travel is a necessity, not a choice. It was a point actually that was well made in what I felt was a thoughtful contribution by Emma Roddick. I heard Liz Smith talk about campaigning for rail infrastructure upgrades between Edinburgh and Perth for 20 years. And I raised yesterday that Fraserburgh and Peterhead are the furthest towns in the entire country from the rail network. Car travel in the North East absolutely is a necessity, not a choice. And remedying this shocking lack of rail provision would absolutely support local growth and connectivity and have many other positive side effects, not least on the drive to net zero and the reduction of car kilometres the government wishes. But when I've raised this with the minister, he abdicates responsibility to the delayed STPR2, which, of course, just yesterday, the Cabinet Secretary failed to give me a precise date of publication on. Perhaps in closing, the minister will state whether he supports, firstly, the reopening of Dyce to Ellen as soon as possible, and then the prompt extension of that to Peterhead and Fraserburgh. And finally, Graham Simpson raised the lack of electrification of the line between Haymarket and Aberdeen. Now, I've asked many questions on this, and if and when the North East might see the £198 million left from the £200 million promised years ago as part of the Aberdeen City Region deal. Who does the Minister abdicate responsibility to this time in his answers? Network Rail. Presiding Officer, this afternoon this chamber has heard a shameful litany of instances where there has been a complete failure of this government to take responsibility. Dean Lockhart demanded the Minister get involved. The Minister has the perfect opportunity right now to show some leadership and take responsibility. Will he? We shall see.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. I heard the reference to Fraserburgh. I think, as Ms Wishart made clear, there are others have claimed to being further away from the train network. But with that, Minister, can you conclude? Again, 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In closing for the Government, I want to make clear, again, some key points. The Government has delivered more routes, more trains, more people travelling on those trains, more stations and greater frequency. Secondly, we shouldn't forget the huge impact of the pandemic, the need to lock down the country and transport services for all but essential travel purposes has had a long-lasting impact. That is why we've just announced a further extension of the Emergency Measures Agreement to provide additional support for ScotRail. We did that on Monday. Our rail services, sadly, are effectively hemorrhaging cash and are running at much more substantive losses than previously. We have to get our railway back onto a surer financial footing whilst also planning for long-term service delivery. Let me be clear, we are determined to do all we can to restore passenger service levels to where they were pre-pandemic, but we face challenges in the short term. The timetable proposals in many areas actually mean better and more frequent services. I appreciate that as cold comfort for those which are facing fewer services than currently, at least in the short term. But it is a consultation, it's not a starting, it's a starting, not an end point, and I encourage, very briefly.
Neil Bibby.
I asked specifically the Minister about the Glasgow, Queen Street to Edinburgh Waverley service via Falkirk High. It's been described as the flagship service between our two largest cities. You shouldn't have to be waiting half an hour to get a train between our two largest cities. Surely the Minister can rule out those cuts of 27% reduction.
As usual, dealing in facts is problematic for Mr Bibby, because let me throw another fact back at him. That service is the one that washes its face on our network, the one service. And those seats are occupied only 26% of the time. That exemplifies the challenge we face about uses. Beatrice Wishart was absolutely right in what she said about the future not being running empty trains. We have to get real about this. Going back to the point about the consultation, I would absolutely encourage members to do, as Liz Smith has done, as Mark Roscoe has done, to get involved in the consultation process. Now, the Labour motion calls for full restoration service levels to pre-COVID, regardless of affordability. What about the new services proposed to be introduced from May the 22nd? Are they to be ditched, or are they suggesting we keep them and add them back in on top of the old services? Because let me tell you, Presiding Officer, you cannot run the same carriages at the same time in different locations. A number of members rightly have raised the issue about the pay claims and industrial action. Graeme Simpson and Mark Ruskell called for a getting round the table. I can advise them and others that such engagement is underway and has been. The unions and management are currently looking at a way forward around pay claims, a way forward that can be made. I know that because I've actively encouraged them to do that, and I've been engaged with a number of the unions. The government agrees that rail employees deserve to be treated and paid fairly. As Transport Minister, I've challenged briefly, if I do have time, Presiding Officer.
Graeme Simpson, as briefly as possible.
Yeah, very quickly. Just on that point about getting around the table, can you explain further what that actually is? Is it mediation?
Minister.
I need to be careful here on what I say, because this is a matter between the unions and Abellio ScotRail, but there are discussions taking place. I can say that, confirm that much. The government agrees that rail employees deserve to be treated and paid fairly. As Transport Minister, I have challenged all parties to identify efficiencies to free up the funding needed to deliver fair and reasonable pay settlements. And I reiterate, Presiding Officer, these need to come from all quarters, including from our strategic relationship with Network Rail. Now, in the SNP, we contend that a fully integrated, publicly controlled railway, not the separation of track and trainers at present, would best serve the needs of staff, customers and the public bus. But alongside pressing the case for that, we will continue to engage with the ORR, seeking a better deal. Because does anyone really believe that paying £815 million per annum for the maintenance of and access to Scotland's rail track alone represents value for money? If we are to reduce overheads, maintain and grow employment levels, increase services and be able to further invest in the network, then this issue has to be addressed. We have a vision for the future of Scotland's railways based on service improvement, fair work and the decarbonisation of passenger rail services. And to answer the question that was asked earlier, we will update Parliament on all of this before the end of the year. But I want to say now, for the avoidance of any doubt, within that, we intend that staff and passenger representation will play a key role in shaping the future direction and governance of the new organisation. We also have ambitions to facilitate a marked increase in rail freight, Presiding Officer, to help meet Scotland's net zero ambitions, as Beatrice Wishart and Emma Roddick called for. Now, I note that the Labour motion fails to mention rail freight. I'm assuming that's just an oversight, because our vision for rail freight is a competitive, sustainable rail freight sector playing an increasing role in Scotland's economic growth by providing a safer, greener and more efficient way of transporting products and materials. And I know that's a vision shared by the trade unions. Presiding Officer, our commitment, long-term commitment to rail remains undiminished. We have some difficult immediate challenges to overcome, but with a real-world approach to addressing these, we can overcome them. We can get Scotland's railway truly fit for the future, a future which meets the needs of the public, is a fair work employer and plays a leading role in cutting transport emissions.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Colin Smith to wind up the debate. 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The decisions we take in the coming months will shape the future of Scotland's railways, and by doing so, they'll shape our response to the climate crisis. Because, as Beatrice Wishart said, transport is Scotland's largest source of greenhouse gases, responsible for more than a third of emissions, with levels barely below what they were in 1990. The last decade under this government has been a missed opportunity to put rail at the heart of our fight back against climate change. Yet in the year, the world's eyes will be on Scotland as we host COP26, when we all hope that agreement will be reached here on our own doorstep that will herald the world's determination not to lose the climate emergency race. It beggars belief that the Scottish Government's swan song for their failed ScotRail franchise is to herald in the single biggest cut in rail services since devolution. And let's be clear, this is a cut in services. It's 300 fewer services a day than there were before the pandemic, 100,000 fewer per year. It really is astonishing that when given the opportunity to rule out reducing the overall number of rail services below pre-pandemic levels, the Minister tried to spin his way out by saying it's fine, the number of services will be more than they are in the middle of a pandemic. And as Emma Roddick said, at a time we're telling people not to use the train. Presiding Officer, is that really what we mean by building back better? Is that the height of this SNP Green Coalition's ambition for our railways. When car travel has crept back to above pre-pandemic level, this SNP Green Coalition has thrown in the towel when it comes to getting back to pre-pandemic levels on our trains, never mind growing them. As Richard Leonard said, at a time of climate crisis, we should be expanding our railways, not contracting them. The Minister said we need to match service patterns with uptake. Well, Labour believes we need to use our every power we have to start to increase that uptake. And, Presiding Officer, we're not going to do that. We won't get people back on our trains by taking those trains away. The Minister even claimed that the proposed new timetable was good for passengers in my region. He highlighted the Nith Valley line and he said it would benefit. So let me tell the Minister what, in my view and my constituents' view, is the real world. These cuts actually mean for my constituents, a region where in many cases the services pre-pandemic weren't good enough. In the Nith Valley line between Glasgow and Dumfries, the number of trains on a weekday will fall from 11 to just 8, a cut of 27%, with a 20% cut in return journeys. Direct services to Newcastle will be axed altogether. There are plans for a reduction from 8 trains to just 5 in each direction between Girvan and Stranraer, a cut of over 37%. Between Ayr and Glasgow, there will be a massive 16 fewer trains a day in each direction, a cut of over 25%. The proposed timetable will mean just 3 trains a day between Kirstairs and Edinburgh. And compared to the pre-pandemic timetable, the proposals reduce the services on the Borders Railway, restricting half-hourly trains to peak times during the week. Of course, we need to align the times of services to meet changes in travel patterns. But that does not mean you need to cut the overall number of services altogether. And that's what Labour's motion talks about today. As Matt Ruskell and the Minister said themselves, we don't know yet what demand will be when we do emerge from the pandemic. What we do know is that if you drive down frequency, you're going to drive down passenger numbers even further. There's been no effort from the Scottish Government to make rail more attractive post-pandemic. Rail fares have rocketed by more than 50% under this government, with passengers facing another hike in ticket prices in the next few months. A season ticket from Tweedbank to Edinburgh will increase by £112 in January. From Ayr to Glasgow, it will rise by £100. Where is the proposed rail fare review from the SNP Green Coalition? Surely that's urgent. Surely we should have had that review before we have this new timetable. And when will we see more urgency when it comes to reopening stations? The Minister talked earlier, as I said, about the Nith Valley line. He mentioned that in this speech and also 2 weeks ago. Well, let me give an example of what he can do to get people back on the trains in those places. He can reopen stations in East Riggs, Thornhill, Mauchline, Cumnock on that line. That will get people on to our trains. Let's show ambition by reopening these stations. Presiding Officer, as Neil Bibby and Richard Leonard highlighted today, the joint trade unions launched their campaign to stop these cuts, 6 months to save Scotland's railway campaign. Labour stands with those workers, key workers who all deserve our thanks for keeping Scotland moving during the pandemic. But they need more than just our thanks. They need and deserve fairness at work and decent pay and conditions. It's not good enough that ScotRail workers haven't had a pay deal for 2 years, including before the pandemic. But it's also not good enough that Scottish Government are quick to hand out millions of pounds in management fees to Serco and Abelia for a 7-day service we're not getting, while at the same time the Government has effectively imposed a pay freeze on ordinary rail workers. And the Minister is frankly posting missing when it comes to resolving an industrial dispute that's dragged on for months. Fortunately, Presiding Officer, this failed franchise itself will only drag on for another few months. The Minister and John Mason said they support public ownership of our railways. Well, frankly, it wasn't that when they opposed not one but 2 motions I brought to this Parliament in the past 3 years to end ScotRail's franchise and deliver, as the Scottish Cooperative Party describe it, a people's railway. Now, I welcome that the SNP have come on board to shunt into their sidings that what we once claimed would be a world-leading franchise, but has, as Neil Bibby said, been a flop from start to finish. But I have to say, if the SNP are really committed to public ownership, why won't they bring the Serco Caledonia sleeper franchise under public control? And I'll do what the Minister failed to do at the start. I'll take an intervention from him if he wants to answer that question.
No, you won't, because you're just about to conclude, Mr Smith.
Much relief to the Minister, I'm sure. Presiding Officer, a fully publicly owned and publicly run railway is Labour's vision for our railways. It's a vision that starts to put passengers first, not the profits of privatised companies. A vision that puts our railways at the heart of the fight against climate change, not accelerates it by cutting services. A vision in which the workforce are the managers of change, not its casualties. We can start to deliver that vision today by backing Labour's motion.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Smith.